Now, I can see that you do not have a clock in the back. And, wow, you are some brave people. Brave. It is great to be here with you. It is a privilege to be able to preach here at the Roebuck Parkway congregation. I do have some family, though, with me. I have my sister, Brooke, and her husband, Rick, and their two children, Caroline and Carter. They live here in Birmingham in the Hoover area and worship at the Hoover congregation. So we're thankful that they came to be here with us tonight. I always love getting to see them as well. And yes, I did. I got to bring with me Brother Nicky McCreelis. I think he's been struggling with his sleep lately, and he needed to get a good nap. So he came with me tonight as well. But it is so good to be here with you this evening. And we are going to start tonight, and we're going to be talking about our Bible, which is a standard of our authority. Now, there are a lot of different ways that we could go when we talk about this idea of our Bible, the standard of authority. And you could think about the Bible as you would compare it maybe to some other religious documents in the world. You might think of some of the other world religions. You might think about the Quran, and you might think about how that the Bible is something that we believe is much better than any of the other documents that you can see in any of the other religious groups. And certainly there's a place for discussion about the merits of the Bible, the Word of God. But tonight, what I want to do is I want us to talk about the Bible that we have, the Bible that we read, and I want us to think about whether that Bible that we read today is the authentic Bible that we need to be listening to, or is there something else that we need to consider as far as God's message for us. Now, I want us to turn over to 2 Peter chapter 3. 2 Peter chapter 3. 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 1 and 2 says, "This is now the second letter that I am writing to you, beloved. In both of them I am stirring up your sincere mind by way of reminder that you should remember the predictions of the holy prophets and the commandment of the Lord and Savior through your apostles." Now, I want you to hold on to that passage of Scripture for a little bit. It might be that in a moment you might underline a few things found in that particular passage. But it's apparent in this text that Peter urges his readers to be mindful of his teachings. Now, in 2 Peter, we find that Peter recognizes that he's not going to be with the brethren for much longer, and he wants to leave them the things that they will need to continue to be the Christians that God wants them to be. And so he is trying to get them to remember the Scriptures that have been written and be mindful of his teachings. On multiple occasions in the Bible, we are told to examine and obey God's Word. One particular passage that comes to mind is 2 Timothy 2:15. "Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth." We go to 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 2, and we see that as babes, newborn babes, desire the sincere milk of the Word that you may grow thereby. So these two passages of Scripture tell us that we need to examine and we need to obey God's Word. Well, we are also told that all Scripture, according to 2 Timothy 3:16, is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped unto all good works. Which documents, then, constitute the Scriptures and are authoritative for us? We have been told to study the Word of God. We have been told that all Scripture has been given by inspiration of God. But here's my question to you. Which Scriptures? Because if you will go and look at some of the other Bibles, even within the Christian religions, you're going to find that there are some differences to the books that they will allow and that those Bibles contain. So our question tonight, and the thing that we want to examine, is this. Which Scriptures are authoritative for us? Now, the question is of obvious importance for the following reasons. And I want to share several reasons why this is important for us to consider. Number one, how do we know that what is included in our Bible is appropriate as opposed to what other groups include in their Bible? Now, I've actually had this discussion with people before. I've actually had people come and question me. I say, well, now, how do you know that what you're studying is the right Scriptures? Maybe some of the Scriptures that I included in my Bible that you don't find in your Bible, maybe those are as authoritative. Maybe there are some lost documents that are authoritative. How do you know that what you have is authoritative? And so it's an appropriate question, because to be honest with you, I want to make sure that when I'm following God's Word, I'm following what He wants me to do. So are our Scriptures, the Bible that we use, is it authoritative for us? Secondly, how do we know what to follow in order to be pleasing to God? This is the question that we need to ask. And these are the questions that are of obvious importance to us, because I want to be pleasing to God. When we think about Ecclesiastes chapter 12 and verse 13, hear the conclusion of the matter. Fear God and keep His commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. I want to be pleasing to the Almighty God, to my Creator. And so these questions are valid questions for us to ask. So what I want us to do tonight is I want us to let Jesus guide us on this quest. You know what? Jesus is going to lead us through some of the statements that He made in the New Testament, in the Gospels, as He is living here. He didn't leave us without a witness to consider these things. And I hope that tonight, as we make this journey in looking at which Scriptures are authoritative, that you'll understand, and this will help you and better fortify your faith in the Bible that we follow. Now, letting Jesus guide us on this quest makes sense, and it makes sense for the following reasons. Number one, because Scripture is inspired by God. 2 Timothy 3:16. We've already established that point. Secondly, because we find, according to John chapter 1, verses 1 through 17, that Jesus is God. The very first verse of John 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Now you go on down to verse 14, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld the glory, even the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So here this passage of Scripture tells us that the Word is God, that all Scripture is inspired by God. Well, we also understand that it's because we will be judged by His Word that it makes sense for us to pay attention to what He has to say about the inspiration of the Scriptures. Now you go to John chapter 12, verse 48, "He who rejects me and does not do my word has one that rejects him. The word that I have spoken, it will judge him in the last days." So we're going to be judged by the Word of God. We understand that Jesus is the Word of God, and we understand that the Scriptures are inspired by God. So it makes sense for us to listen to Jesus on this subject so that we can understand which Scriptures He believed was authoritative for us. Now, using Jesus as our guide, let's determine what Scriptures are authoritative. First, we're going to deal with the Old Testament. Then, we're going to move into the New Testament. We're going to look at these things together. Now, Jesus authorizes the following Old Testament books. In Matthew chapter 5, verses 17, and again in Matthew chapter 7 and verse 12, Jesus gives support here for the law and the prophets. Now, He's going to talk about in Matthew chapter 5, "I did not come to abolish the law and the prophets. No, I came to fulfill them." And then we go to Matthew chapter 7 and verse 12, and we remember the golden rule, and "Do unto others as you would have them do unto you, for all this is all the law and the prophets." So here Jesus establishes that the law and the prophets are important for us to follow. Well, let's move further. In Luke 24, 44 through 45, Jesus states that the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms are to be considered Scripture. Now, how do we know that? Well, let's turn over there to that passage of Scripture together, and I want us to read that text with one another. Luke chapter 24, verse 44. "Then He said to them, 'These are My words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about Me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled.' Then He opened their minds to understand the Scriptures." What does Jesus call the Scriptures there? Jesus calls the Scriptures the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms. Now that's significant, folks. It's very significant, especially if you understand the Hebrew Bible, and that's what we're going to talk about. Jesus quotes the Old Testament scriptures in his teachings. And so it's important for us to listen to that. If Jesus quotes the Old Testament scriptures in his teaching, then those are scriptures that are authoritative. They're scriptures we need to listen to and be obedient to. Now, what I want us to notice is this. The Hebrew scriptures called the Tanakh were made up of the exact 39 books that you know as the Old Testament today. Now, they only had them in 24 books. Let me explain why. There are some books that they combined. When you read about 1 and 2 Samuel, 1 and 2 Kings, 1 and 2 Chronicles, they didn't have 1 and 2 Kings. They had Kings, they had Samuel, they had Chronicles. When you think about the minor prophets, they didn't have all of the minor prophets listed individually and in individual epistles. They considered those one book. They called it the 12. The 12 minor prophets. And so they reduced the number of the books that they had. So their books were 24. The same 39 that we have today. Now folks, this is important because these are the Hebrew scriptures. The Hebrew scriptures that Jesus would have had access to, even though at the time that Jesus was living, there was also a book called the Septuagint, and we're going to get to that in just a few moments. Now, Hebrew scriptures are called the Tanakh. They were made up of the exact 39 books that we have today. The Tanakh was divided into three major sections of scrolls. Three major sections. Well, I want you to go back to our reading in Luke chapter 24, verse 44. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I have spoken to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Well, guess what the three major sections of those scrolls included? The three major sections of those scrolls included the law of Moses was one. Then talks about the prophets. And then there was the section called the writings, and the largest of the books in there, and the main book in the heading, was the Psalms. So when Jesus talks about the scriptures here in Luke chapter 24, verse 44, what he's doing is he is authorizing for us the Hebrew scriptures that they had at that time. And so it's important for us to remember that those scriptures, the 39 books that we have in our Bible, those books are authoritative according to Jesus. Those were the scriptures that he read, that he studied, that he believed in, that he fulfilled. Now, what about the books of the Apocrypha? All right. Now, we've talked about this a little bit. These books, and you're going to find several of them. In fact, I could give you a list of several of the books that you might find in the Apocrypha of the Old Testament. You might find the book of Tobit and Judith and Wisdom of Solomon and Wisdom of Jesus, son of Sirach, and Baruch, Letter of Jeremiah, the Maccabees 2:1, 2, 3, 4, Esdras, Prayer of Manasseh, all of these different, and there are others that I could list to tell you about, but these books were considered books of the Apocrypha. And they were included in the Septuagint, but notice something about those books. These books were never written in Hebrew, and they were never included in the Tanakh, which were the Hebrew scriptures that contained three scrolls. They were written in Greek, and they were included in the Septuagint. Now, Jesus quoted from the Septuagint. In fact, if you go back and do a study of the quotations of the Old Testament of Jesus, you're going to find that about 90% of the quotations that he made came from the Latin version, or the Greek version, which was the Septuagint. And only about 10% of his quotations came from Hebrew. But notice this. Jesus recognized only the authority of the 39 books that we call the Old Testament today because he never quoted from any of the Apocrypha books. He only quoted from the three scrolls of the Hebrew writings. The 24 books that they had, that they considered in Hebrew, even though he would quote them in Greek for the people there, he never quoted from the Apocrypha. He only quoted from the 24 books in the Tanakh, which are the exact 39 books we have. So what does that tell you? It tells you that Jesus recognized the 39 books of the Old Testament that we have as being Scripture and being authoritative. Now I'm wanting to build faith in the book that we call our Bible for you tonight. And I want Jesus to guide us in that. Jesus never dealt with Apocrypha literature, the things that some people include in there. He only dealt with the 39 books that we have. So, Jesus recognized the authority of the 39 books we call the Old Testament today. Now, Jesus authorizes the following New Testament books. Now, this is going to be a little bit trickier because at the time that these books were written, Jesus had already died and been resurrected. So, we're going to have to study this a little bit in the context of His followers as well. We know that Jesus lived under the Old Covenant. We know that He honored that and He came to what? It says, fulfill the law and the prophets. So the Scriptures, the Hebrew Scriptures, were authoritative for Him. That's what He was obedient to. That's what He fulfilled perfectly so that He could be the perfect sacrifice for us. But what about the New Testament books? How are we going to find that Jesus authorizes those for us today? Well, before we move forward, we need to rightly divide the Word of Truth. Again, in 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 15, we'll say, study to show thyself approved unto God, workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And you've heard this before. I'm not telling you any secret, something that you've never heard. We know that we've got to rightly divide the word of truth. By that we mean that things in the Old Testament that those people had to be obedient to, they're things that we don't have to be obedient to today. We're not offering animal sacrifices anymore. We're not worshiping on the Sabbath day. We're not living according to the Old Covenant. And so the Old Testament Scriptures, although valuable for us and beneficial when it comes to learning lessons from those Scriptures, we understand that they're not our authority in the things that we do now in this Christian age. And so it's important for us to rightly divide that and understand that the New Testament stands as our authoritative guide today. So we've got to rightly divide the Word of Truth. Second, we talked about this. Jesus came to void the old covenant and establish a new covenant. One of the Scriptures recorded in Colossians that He nailed it to the cross, that old covenant, and He established a new covenant, Luke 22, verse 20. Now, in Acts chapter 1 and verse 7, He gave His apostles authority through the Holy Spirit. Now, if we go back to the book of John, we're going to see where that on three different occasions Jesus speaks to His disciples and His apostles about this. The first time that we can find this is found in John chapter 14. In verse 26, He says, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in My name, He will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I have said to you. Now you turn over just a few pages to chapter 15, verse 26 again. He says, but when the Helper comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth, who proceeds from the Father, He will bear witness about Me. In verse 13 of chapter 16, when the Spirit of truth comes, He will guide you into all the truth, for He will not speak on His own authority, but whatever He hears, He will speak, and He will declare to you the things that are to come. Now, fast forward with me over to Acts chapter 1. In Acts chapter 1, verse 7, look together at this passage of Scripture. He said to them, it is not for you to know times or seasons that the Father has fixed by His own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be My witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. Now, we see that this promise is made to Jesus. He's about to ascend to His Father. And we see the fulfillment of this again in Acts chapter 2. When all of those apostles were gathered together and the Holy Spirit fell upon them. And Peter with the 11 got up and he began to preach that gospel sermon. And all the people that were there that were from other nations heard the message of hope preached to them in their own language, their own tongue. Here's the fulfillment of what Jesus has said. He's going to send that Holy Spirit. He's going to guide them into all the truth. Now, the word power in this passage that we find is the Greek term exousia. And this term means authority or jurisdiction. In fact, you're going to find this term used in other places in the Scriptures as well. One case is in John chapter 19. The word's used three times in Jesus' conversation with Pilate. They're talking about authority, and that's how it's translated in the English Standard Version. The word exousia is, or power, is translated authority. Jesus is telling Pilate, well, you wouldn't have any authority except someone more powerful, more authoritative than you had given you that authority. So on three occasions, this term is used. So here in this passage of Scripture in Acts chapter 1, verse 7, we see where that the apostles were given authority. Authority by Jesus through the Holy Spirit. Now, the apostle Peter, privy to several private episodes with Jesus. One such occasion is mentioned in 2 Peter. Chapter 1, 16 through 17. If we look at that passage of Scripture, we're going to find that Peter is calling our attention to the occasion that he had with Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration. Verses 16 and 17. For we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of His majesty. For when He received honor and glory from God the Father, and the voice was borne to Him by the majestic glory, this is My beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. He says, we were there with Him. We were eyewitnesses to His majesty. And so Peter was privy to some of these special occasions with Jesus. And in addition to having these private episodes with Jesus, he was given the honor of having possession to the keys of the kingdom of heaven. You go back to Matthew chapter 16, and you notice there verses 16 and following there that Peter makes that confession that Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Jesus asking his disciples, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? And they were giving him all kinds of answers. They were saying, well, some say you're Elijah, some say you're Jeremiah or one of the prophets. And then he asked them specifically, but who do you say? In other words, what he's asking is, who do you believe I am? Peter said, you're the Christ, Son of the living God. So upon that confession, Jesus says, and I'll give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. Whatsoever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatsoever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. So here we've got the Apostle Peter, privy to several private episodes with Jesus, saw His majesty, eyewitnessed His glory, understood that the voice came, said, this is My beloved Son, whom I'm well pleased, confessed that Jesus was God's Son, was given the kingdom of heaven, or the keys to the kingdom of heaven. He speaks to the authority of the New Testament. And he does so in the passage that we read just a little bit ago. 2 Peter, we go back to that particular passage of Scripture, and we think about what he has to say here. 2 Peter 3 and 2, Peter accepts the authority first of the prophets and then the commandments of the Lord given through the apostles. He accepts the authority. It's been given. Well, let's look a little closer at this. Let's turn to 2 Peter chapter 3. Actually, let me see here. Let me go back to 1 Peter chapter 3. Nope, I'm right. 2 Peter chapter 3. I want to notice verses 15 and 16. And count the patience of our Lord as salvation, just as our beloved brother Paul also wrote to you according to the wisdom given him, as he does in all his letters when he speaks in them of these matters. There are some things in them that are hard to understand, which the ignorant and unstable twist to their own destruction, as they do the other, what? The other Scriptures. So here in 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 15 through 16, Peter refers to all of Paul's epistles as Scripture. What our brother Paul has written, that is Scripture. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God. That's authoritative for me. Now here's something else to consider. When you think about the writings of the Apostle Paul, We know that he wrote 13 books. Feel like that he probably wrote 14. There's debate about whether he is the writer of the book of Hebrews. But regardless, if that's the case, then this one man wrote almost half of the New Testament. Half of the New Testament that you have. So Peter refers to all of Paul's epistles as scriptures. Now, again, going back to 2 Peter chapter 3, and I want us to look again at verses 1 and 2. This is now the second letter that I'm writing to you. Beloved, in both of them I am stirring up your sincere mind by way of reminder that you should remember the predictions of the holy prophets and the commandment of the Lord and Savior through your apostles. Through your apostles. All the New Testament books were either written by apostles or by men who were closely associated to those apostles. And men whom the apostles had laid their hands on and passed the gift, the Holy Spirit, to, so that they could continue to teach about things in an authoritative way. Now, I want us to just examine a few of these things together. Look at the 27 books. Well, we won't look at all 27, but what we will do is we'll look at those that penned the 27 books. Okay, what we got? We got Matthew, Gospel of Matthew, apostle. You got Mark, also known as John Mark. Now, you know John Mark from Acts. He is the one that Paul and Barnabas took on a missionary journey, and he went back home, and when they were about to embark on another missionary journey, there was a dissension between the two because he had left, and the strife was so severe that Paul says, I'm going with Silas, and we're going one way, and Barnabas says, I'm taking John Mark, we're going the other way. But still, John Mark was associated with Paul, and we find also in 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 11, nearing the end of Paul's life, he tells Timothy, I want you to send Mark to me, for he's useful for me for the ministry. Then we find in Peter, 1 Peter 5 and 13, we get the idea and the impression, and many believe that Mark was a person who Peter took under his wing. That Peter was a mentor to John Mark. And in fact, here in the closing part of this passage of Scripture, in Peter, he's talking to the church at Babylon, and he sends greetings by his son, Mark, the same John Mark. So Mark associated closely with Paul and especially with Peter. Most people believe that John Mark, in the writing of his gospel, transcribed what the apostle Peter wanted him to write. He wrote because of what Peter had witnessed and observed. So close association with these apostles. Luke, the beloved physician, travel companion with Paul. We know this from Acts chapter 21. If you go there, and you're going to find this in other chapters as well. Sometimes Luke, as he's writing, you can see evidence that he may not have been with Paul at that particular time, because he might make the statement that he went here or he went there. But in chapter 21 of Acts, you're going to find that Luke is with Paul because he keeps using the pronoun we. And we set sail from there, and we went to this place, and we did this or we did that. And so he was a travel companion with the Apostle Paul, and obviously would have recorded things that the Apostle Paul was privy to. Basically, what Luke was writing was the history of Paul anyways as a Christian and his journeys. So certainly, Luke would have drawn from Paul the information that he was writing. We find the fourth gospel, John, apostle. Paul began at Romans, go through Philemon or Hebrews, apostle. James, brother of the Lord, elder of the church in Jerusalem, and fellow laborer with Peter and John. We see evidence of this in Galatians chapter 2 and 9. He was a pillar, called a pillar of the church in Jerusalem. He was also a fellow laborer of Paul. You can find their association in Acts chapter 15 and in Acts chapter 21. Peter, an apostle, wrote 1 and 2 Peter. Jude, probably the brother of James listed above, He also was associated with all the apostles, because if you go to Acts chapter 1, as those 11 were gathering, minus Judas, waiting for the promise that Jesus had made for them, who was gathered with them? It says Mary, the mother of Jesus, and all his brothers. And we're not just talking about spiritual brothers. The actual term there in the Greek is siblings. Siblings of Jesus, along with their mother, had assembled with the apostles as the apostles were waiting for the promise that Jesus had given to be fulfilled. So when we look at all of these, this evidence, this association with the apostles and the power and the authority that was given to them by Jesus Christ through the Holy Spirit, and folks, we can feel confident about the 27 books we study and are authoritative in our life. In fact, if you go back and think about it, 22 of the 27 books were written by apostles, that leaving only 5 that were written by other men, but other men that were closely associated and the apostles had laid their hands on so that they might be able to transmit the authoritative information that we need to guide us in our life. So we're letting Jesus guide us on this quest to find the authority of the Scriptures. Now, I don't know how much time I have. Generally, they only give me a little bit of time. I'm about out of time. They only give me about 20 minutes to 25 minutes at Flint, so this is just like, this is amazing here. Hey, keep going. So as a point of review, we go back, we think about the Hebrew writings. We want to find out which of the documents in the Old Testament are authoritative. We think about the Tanakh, which was the Hebrew Scriptures. They were contained in 3 scrolls. Jesus makes reference to those 3 scrolls, and he quoted from all 3 of the scrolls in his ministry. Those are the authoritative Scriptures of the Old Testament. Not the Apocrypha, not what somebody else has included in their Bible, the 39 books that you have today. Today, we can feel very confident about the authority of the 27 books of the New Testament that we have, because they were written by apostles or men closely associated with those apostles. And if you go back to Peter, remember what he says, that you should remember the predictions of the holy prophets and the commandment of the Lord and the Savior through your apostles. So the Bible, we've been talking about the Bible, our standard. Folks, we feel confident about this document. We believe in Jesus Christ. We feel confident that we have the message that he wants us to have. We have all things that Peter would also say that pertains to what? Life and godliness. And this is all we need. And it's our standard. Thank you for your time and your attention tonight.